actually can turn it down a little bit.
All right, let's get a saucepan going. I need to wash this one. Huge noticeable difference, yeah. I think it's just as simple as like learning how to prioritize what you can spend extra money on and get value out of it, right? When I'm making soup, I'm all about getting like better meat. But some stuff just tastes better with kind of bad stuff. I would argue that a burger, for example, tastes better with lower quality ground meat than fancy stuff. Part of that might just be my upbringing, and that's just what burgers tasted like growing up, but... Corpor! Hello, hello, welcome! Hope you are having a pleasant day. We are just about to make our ramen tare. And then we're gonna make some noodles. How are you? Even that 70-30 vac pack tube, I'm telling you, that stuff makes great burgers. It really is great. Oop. Kenara, welcome in. Woo-wee, your timing is good. Here we go, I'm just angling my stove cam real quick. Welcome in, Peters. How are you? How was your stream? Welcome in, welcome in. Organic or farm egg? Eggs makes a difference, 100%. Welcome in, everyone. After Raiden Dash, he gets Derek's performance. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Enjoy, enjoy. Thank you so much for the raid. I appreciate it. Your stream was lovely, but I'm sure it was. I'll say hello to everyone here. Hello, everyone. My name is Graham. Welcome to my kitchen. This is Tabitite Cooking. I'm sure I got a little bit of an intro from Kanara there because she's so thoughtful, but yeah, I make a lot of ramen on stream in my PJ pants, and that's what we're doing today. I'll sort of give you guys a little tour if you want. We have just put together our ramen eggs. So I've got my Ajitama sort of going in the fridge right now. We are working on our tare at the moment, which is our seasoning for our broth. I'm about to toast up some niboshi in this pan on the stove for you guys. So pull up a seat. If you have any questions, feel free to let me know. Thank you for the follows, guys. I appreciate it. The thousand-year-old egg? No, 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 no. Those are called piton or pidon. And those are duck eggs that are cured in like ammonia and lye. I do really like them, but we're not doing those for ramen. We're not doing those for ramen.
Wow. Paul Batoy!
Oh, Littering, thank you very much for the follow. I appreciate it. Veggies and greens is much better, yeah. And I'll tell you, like, some of the best eggs I've ever had in my life were in, like, Indonesia, where the chickens literally just, like, eat bugs that they find, you know? Those eggs were good. All right, so ramen broth is underway. See a sunny hair? Oh no, it's just stuck to the monitor. Okay. So this is gonna be our tare. So this is our seasoning. And over here, we've got our broth going. And that's still got a few hours left, so we're gonna leave that alone. But we're gonna make the seasoning sauce that gives the ramen its salt and flavor. I'm gonna try and get this as close as I can to the saucepan without having it fall in. There we go, much better. Return, my Wi-Fi had a hiccup. Well, welcome back. Preserved eggs are good in porridge, yeah. I've heard they're great in congee, but I've never had them that way. Like, I just sort of eating them as snacks. I do like them. Favorite kind of ramen? Mine is tonkotsu. Mine? So, I don't know. That's a big question. I've been making ramen at home since, like, 2016. I think I'm probably in the hundreds of bowls at this point. And I think my favorite to eat is probably chicken shoyu. But my favorite to make is chicken paitan. Cloudy broth, chicken stock. made with rapid boil, and then you mash up the bones when they get soft, and then you get this, like, it's very tonkotsu-like texture, but it's all chicken. I really like it. It's delicious. All right, I'm gonna put a little oil in there, and we're gonna heat that up. I'm gonna wait for that to get hot before I add the niboshi, though, so. And then our niboshi is this stuff.
Wow.
Got little anchovies that have been salt dried. And we're gonna toast those in some oil, and that's gonna be sort of the backbone of the flavor behind the tare. So we got some katsuobushi, some kombu and stuff, and we're just gonna have a little umami party. But welcome in, everyone. I hope everyone is having a pleasant day. I would reckon, just looking at the color on the soup, probably got like 3 hours left for that to cook. So I don't know, maybe in another hour and a half or so, I'll add some aromatics, some cabbage, onion, ginger, that kind of thing. We'll get that in there. But right now it's just chicken and pork bones, and that's it. All right. Give this stuff a little swirl. All right, I'm gonna take a sip of water. I feel like it's been a while. Are there actually backbones in there? Chicken backs and pork femurs mostly. And then I've got a pork trotter and a whole stewing hen in there as well. Never had real ramen, I need to fix that. You know, I would actually be really keen to know what kind of ramen is being served in South America, you know? I have no idea. It'd be interesting. If you do get it locally, I would be very interested in a photo. And, you know how it tastes. Oh, fish backbones. Yeah. So this is whole fish, basically, that I've split them open to remove the organs. But this is how they come packaged. Camera wants to focus. There we go. This is how they come packaged. You can actually just eat them, too, like as a beer snack. But, I like to make ramen sauce with them, so that's what I'm doing. On fish broth right now? Dude, fish broth is legit. What's up, Proudstone? Favorite instant ramen tonkotsu is from an Iron Chef called Morimoto. I've met that guy, actually, yeah. Reinvented instant ramen. Well, I mean, that might be giving him a lot of credit. I will say, his instant ramen is very good. I like that it's air-dried instead of defrigerated, and the tonkotsu flavor is delicious. But yeah, I would argue my favorite instant is probably this Japanese brand called Demae Icho. This stuff. This is a really good tonkotsu too, if you want to track it down. But if this stuff at the Asian market is normally like 79 cents a bag.
Tall but tall!
Black garlic version. And then, Nishin Ra-O. Nishin Ra-O, it's in like gold and green. Package. That one is also delicious. So keep an eye out for that one. Thank you very much for the follow. Welcome in. Third Iron Chef Japanese. He was great on the original show. Yeah. He's a really nice guy in person, too. Like, very, like, sort of shy? Anyway, I got a photo with him. Think about it. Would have been right before the pandemic, so it would have been, I guess, probably sometime in late 2019. Let's see if I can find it real quick. Might be on my old phone, which would be very unfortunate. Well, there's me and Babish. Definitely after that. Look at all these food photos I used to take. Pictures of Sunny. Oh man, I don't know where this guy is. Oh well, you'll have to trust me. It happened. Well, was it? Because I thought I went up by myself because it was for the book signing. Yeah, I don't know. Too many food photos. I can't go through it. Sunny's here. She is nervous about the new kitchen, so she doesn't love hanging out in here. We'll see if she comes in here. Hang on a second.
Wow. Love Chen, yeah.
Wow. Corporal says, hi, Amanda. And most of the stuff they did, I didn't like. Fish heads and all the weird stuff. The weird stuff is delicious, though.
Yeah. I'm about to pull it out here. Check that oil, make sure it's not burning. There she is. Now let me focus real quick. Zoom in. There she is. There's Sunny. Sunny, you a good girl? Just paying attention to Amanda because Amanda's got the treats. She's so nervous about the new kitchen, I think. I don't know why. Maybe because it's like so narrow. All right, put this down. Whoa! Time to toast some fish. No, it's actually the same model of kitchen stove as we had at our old place, Miss Kichi. What a coincidence, huh? All right, so we got a little oil in there. Put that fish in. We're just gonna get that toasted until it stinks the house up. Nice. This is gonna be strong. Strong stuff. Made pork instant ramen yesterday and added Canadian bacon. Yeah, nothing wrong with that at all. We were just talking about bacon ramen, as a matter of fact, like maybe 20 minutes ago. David Chang does a really well-known bacon aroma oil in his ramen, I think. Applewood smoke? No, sounds great. I'm into that. All right. Soy sauce and kombu going in after this. It smells a little bit like fish-flavored popcorn. Smells delicious though. Toasty, fishy. Until it stinks the house up, exactly. Or becomes aromatic. That's the language they use in recipes. When they mean until it stinks your house up. Saute garlic until aromatic. Saute fish until aromatic. Here we go. That's kombu and soy sauce added. Fermented mudfish in her cooking sometimes. Is it fermented mudfish? We used to, I used to work in Indonesia. I lived there for like 3 months, and in the cooking there, they use this stuff called shrimp paste. It's just mashed up shrimp that have been allowed to ferment. And it carries a smell. But I mean, you put a little bit of that into a pan right before making like a nasi goreng or sambal, and it'll you gotta open some windows. You know what I mean? It's strong. Oh boy, aren't you aromatic today? Oh, I hope you get a chance. I hope you get a chance to use that. Who wrong? Delag? Belican? Belichan? Belichan? Something like that. Think of the whole house, absolutely. Oh, Lucky, you're Dutch. Have you used it before? Because this stuff gets some use, and Dutch people are familiar with it. Stinks so good, exactly. Delicious. All right, we're gonna heat this up to 160 Fahrenheit and hold it there for about 10 minutes. And then we're gonna take the kombu out. So we're steeping all the flavor out of this kombu. This is Hidaka kombu. This is stuff that I bought in Japan. Kind of like that, yeah. Always had it at the old house. Yeah, you gotta open the windows when you heat that stuff up, because you're supposed to toast dry just in a pan. It's sort of like as a foundation flavor for your sauce, for the sambal or whatever it is you're making. And hoo-wee, that stuff. Who It was funny because, like, the first time I heated it up at home, Amanda, like, had to go for a walk. But our dog, Winston, would come back into the kitchen just like, it smells good in here. Shrimp cheese. Yeah, so you just need a little bit of something really strongly fermented to do the job, right? That's sort of what we're using the Niboshi for here. That's only 20 grams of fish, you know? But because it's dried, the flavor is like so concentrated. Delicious. Are you gonna add sliced eggs? I'd like to learn how to make those. Joe King, you have missed the eggs. But I'll rattle out my recipe real quick. Basically, you just take them out of the fridge, put them in boiling water for 7 minutes, stir for the first 2 or 3 minutes, and then you weigh how much the container weighs and subtract that. Basically, you make an equilibrium brine, roughly equal parts soy sauce and mirin, and then they're good in there up to 4 days. But yeah, it's the only tricky thing is you need to scale to get the equilibrium just right. But if you want a quick brine, you can use the equal parts soy sauce, mirin, and sake. And that'll get it done really quickly, like within a couple hours. Hey, John, welcome in. Did y'all's mead survive the move? Corpor, we actually sampled some of the mead last night. And it was shockingly good for being 12 years old. Like, I was really afraid it would be ruined. It wasn't really carbonated anymore. It was carbonated like 10 years ago still. But it was holding positive pressure in the bottle, which is a good sign. So it means that, like, there was no bacterial infection or anything like that to worry about. Mirin and soy, is that like teriyaki? Yeah, a little bit. Mirin and sake, you've got like 2/3 of your Japanese mirepoix right there. Yeah. Yeah, we opened one of the meads last night. Got like maybe a third of the bottle left. It's not really sparkling anymore. It was better when it was sparkling, but it does taste delicious. You can still taste a little bit of that orange blossom honey in there. It's quite good.
Oh, I like noodles and Amanda. That's my Tabitha impression.
Oh, I've been drinking mimosas since 11. Oh, no. Thank you for the resub, man. Hey, it's Taz's birthday weekend, everybody. Say happy birthday. How long can you keep eggs in that brine? Up to about 3 or 4 days. Sunday brunch running into dinner. That's just a normal Sunday at the Taz household, I think. Thanks, bye. See, Taz doesn't like being the center of attention. He loves being the center of attention. All right, 160 Fahrenheit, please. Ooh-wee, that's too hot. All right, we can turn that burner off. We're gonna hold it there for 10 minutes. I'm just gonna package this up with the kombu, I think. That sauce you told me to add to ramen that people would keep through generations. Curious myself. Oh. Good Niboshi. These are sardines I bought in Aomori Prefecture in February when I was there with Amanda. They smell very nice if you're into sardines and anchovies. All right, I'm going to make a little room because we are very close to noodle time. So all the tare ingredients, I'm going to go ahead and just move over to the stove area. Check on the soup real quick, make sure it's not boiling too hard. Looks all right to me. This stove does a really good job of even heat. Maybe it's in better condition than our old stove was. Master Stock, very similar to Tari, you could defo add that to ramen. Yeah, so Master Stocks, there are, I've heard of a few places that use them for ramen. I'd say it's probably less common. Probably less common than it is in like America. I know of a few places that do it in the Southeast, actually, for like chilies and soups and stuff. News, what's up, Porter Hawk? We are close to noodle time, like very close. We're gonna steep this for another 10 minutes. I'm gonna strain it, and then we're gonna add our katsuobushi. and then our tare will be just about done. Yeah, we're gonna raise it to 180 after this and give the katsuobushi 5 minutes in there, and then we're gonna strain the whole thing. Perfect. And then we just have a perfect tare for matching 10 to 1 with soup. We're actually gonna scorch this in a wok right before service today, though. So it's gonna be interesting. We're gonna have a very dramatic plating tonight. I'm excited. Certain Chinese places will have dishes using master stock. That sounds right. It's my birthday this Thursday. I have no clue what to do. John, I was trying to remember. We're like the same age, aren't we? We're both 40, is that right? Or are you turning 40? Am I older than you? Doing nothing is also a plan. Trust me, after 40, it sounds pretty damn good. Similar composition to dashi, soy, rock sugar, and rice wine. Ah, gotcha. Gotcha. Don't normally find sugar in dashi, though. Turning 40, okay. So I've got you by what? 4 months? My birthday was in November. Got you by 4 months. Well, congratulations, man. 40's huge. My 30s were pretty excellent. Looking forward to keeping some forward momentum, some positive momentum into my 40s. And I hope the same for you. You deserve it. I was looking at the wrong spot because my use of my camera being in a different place. All right. We're gonna do a proper cleaning on this counter. I think I'm done with these for now. We'll save those for later though, because I might need them again. All my dashi ingredients can go away. All right. The tricky thing is, because of where the camera's located, it's gonna be better to put the machine here and roll the noodles out this way. Yeah. 7 minutes left. Let's go ahead and bring the new machine out. Just gonna hit this with some disinfectant. We're working with chicken and stuff on here earlier, and I don't want to put raw noodle dough through any of that. It'll get traumatized enough. Tempted to go out to eat. Don't do it, it's a trap. Honestly, like, it's one of those things, like, getting into food streaming, I didn't realize how little it meant I would be going out to eat. We live in what is maybe one of the best food cities in America, and I go out to eat so infrequently. It's kind of embarrassing. P. Goaty, thank you for the follow. Welcome in. All right. Actually, before I break the machine out, I'm going to just get a mixing bowl out for putting these ingredients together. Actually, my bowl is over here. There we go. Rarely go out to eat. Same. We have counter view, please. Yes. For noodles, absolutely.
Wow.
No restaurant will meet your standards.
Wow.
Just life after COVID. Yeah, we were like this before COVID, though. Still haven't been to Tad's Deli. I decided that next time I do like a Pike Place area live stream, we'll stop in. But yeah, still haven't been. I used to, back when I lived down south, I would drive by Pike Place every morning on my way to work. But the line was just out the door every day. Yeah, corporate, that was always my thing, was like having people come over and then I cook dinner for the group. That was always my thing. Which, you know, how did I make the jump to streaming? All right, I need my kansui salts. I need my flour. And I even bought new egg white powder for you guys. Do you feel spoiled? We'll need the scale again, too. Opening a Greek deli near... Dude, I love a Greek deli. Get a lot of delivery, but hardly ever go out to eat. Entertaining with a capital E, exactly. Egg white powder, why not use real eggs? Good question. Sometimes I will use whole egg noodles. Oh dear, who's that? Herbsky, there's a username. Welcome in. Thank you very much for the raid, hope you're doing well. I'm going to find my egg white powder, which... Oh. I feel like I left it out on purpose. Egg white powder? Have you seen it? You're allowed to say no.
Oh, I like noodles and Amanda.
Herbsky, how's your stream? Impression, everyone. Ah, there you go. Thank you. New bag. I forgot what it looked like. Herbsky is my friend who is new to streaming. Rihanna, it's so nice to see you. Thank you for... sounds like you may have influenced that raid a little bit. I hope everything in the stream today was good. Cedar, thank you very much for the resub. So nice to see you. Yeah, new kitchen. We're here. We made it. Thank you very much. Burpsky, welcome. My name is Graham. Sure, Rihanna told you a little bit, but I'm primarily a cooking streamer. Sometimes I do IRL content. And this is my second stream in this new kitchen that we have. And I'm making ramen. We're just about to put our noodle dough together. Tari's on the stove. Vandrosa. Whenever I see one of you, I'm like...
That's my Tabata impression.
The countdown begins. The countdown begins. Honestly, yesterday was super chill. This is a bit longer, a little bit more of like a complex dish. So I think this is the one to catch. But thank you so much, guys. Welcome in. Yeah, I do put dumplings in ramen sometimes. There's a style of ramen called wonton men, which is really just like... It's soup, wontons, and soup, you know? But sometimes that makes a really good, like, topping if you want to go lighter on meat or, you know, there was, like, a chestnut ramen I made one time that had chestnut wontons in there. That was delicious. Yeah, I mess around with that sometimes. My angel. Well, thank you so much. Thank you so much for the raid. I really do appreciate it. So we had a question a minute ago about why not use whole eggs. Because egg yolks are a shortener, a gluten chain shortener. And they do make the dough softer, but at the cost of that hard, glutinous texture that you really look for in ramen. I really look for in ramen. So using a measured amount of egg white powder allows me to bring in some hydrophobic qualities to the noodles without shortening the gluten chains. And the batch size that I'm working with wouldn't require a full egg anyway. So it allows me to use a portion of an egg more precisely than trying to cut up a raw egg on the counter. Does that make sense? So egg white powder, not necessary. In fact, most times I don't even use it, but I'm gonna use it today. thank you very much for the follow, Bursty, by the way. I appreciate that. Food science, that's right, that's right. Noodle making is very scientific in nature, very precise. One of the reasons I like it. All right, we have to take our kombu out of here. So I'm gonna take care of that real quick. Let me throw down a towel. I'm not trying to split my new counters. There we go. All right, so once kombu has been cooked in water, you make a dashi. But we've cooked this in soy sauce with niboshi and everything in there. So normally after you cook it, you can eat it, but I wouldn't recommend eating this one because it'll taste very strong. What you can do is you could actually dry this out and shred it and turn it into furikake, some rice seasoning, if you wanted. But I wouldn't recommend just taking a piece out and eating it. So much in here, it's gonna take a minute for me to find every piece. This is Hidaka kombu, if anybody's wondering. You're so smart. Do enjoy a good puzzle. Now, the real answer is I've just done a ludicrous amount of reading on the topic, and probably assess way harder over it than a lot of people I know. That's all it takes. That's all it takes to get good at something, is you just have to be willing to obsess. Is that a piece? No, that's all fish. So these are shredded anchovies we've got in here that have been salt cured. All right, we're gonna put this back on the stove. We're going to add our katsuo flakes. They're over here. I've got some thick and thin cut hanakatsuo in there. We're gonna give these 5 minutes at about 180 degrees to sort of give up their flavor. Then we get to strain the whole thing out. And check temp, make sure we don't overheat it. If you heat the heat it up too much, it'll sort of get bitter or sour, and I don't want that. All right, we're at 135. We got to get it to 180. I'm going to leave it on medium. Hanakatsuo. Hanakatsuo is like very thin cut katsuobushi flakes. Yeah. I know nothing about that. Tex probably knows more than I do, honestly, about like Japanese food in general. I just am like hyper-focused on noodles. Hyper-focused on noodles. All right, actually, speaking of, I need that out still. Let me wipe down the counter again because I think I saw a drop of soy sauce hit the counter. We can't have that. We have to be free of contaminants for our noodle dough. All right. You need 400 grams of bread flour. Should I angle the scale towards you guys so you can actually see? There we go. It's not bad. Zoom in a bit. I'll block the light with my body. There we go. Sort of. All right, get that out of the way, and then the camera should focus on the bowl. Sort of. There we go. All right, so that's 157. We need 400. My machine is so large, and this is not a flex, I swear, that I can only move in 400 gram batches of noodle dough. So I start with 400 grams of wheat flour. I use bread flour for the higher gluten, and that helps with gluten chain formation during the rolling process. You can use all-purpose flour, the noodles will just be a bit softer. 400 grams of bread flour. You can also work in other stuff piecemeal, right? Like my, I have a Washington style ramen that I make that I actually use, I think it's 8% buckwheat flour in. So of the 100 grams of flour I add per portion, 8 grams of it will be soba flour and 92 grams of it will be bread flour. So you can mix and match like that too. Ooh. Please don't spill this egg white powder. Oh, okay, I think we're good. I felt bad. I don't like when they ship these bags unsealed, and then like you get egg white powder and stuff into the Ziploc seal side of the, this feels bad, man. All right, we need 4 grams of egg white powder, which, as a callback to my earlier point, way less than a full egg is, right? 4 grams of egg white powder. If you go a little bit over or under, that's fine. But I'm going to be as precise as I can be. 4 grams. There we go. Must be talking about Fettuccine Mercury. That's the one. Actually, the noodle machine has a space like just outside of the camera range, so I don't have to walk across the room to pick it up anymore. It's nice. All right, I'm just dusting this off, keeping that spoon dry, because if I don't, I'll get water into my kansui mix, and I don't want that. All right, so this is our dry ingredients, flour and egg white powder. Don't even have to mix those together, really, at this point. We'll stir just before we mix in the water. Now, I'm gonna check temp real quick on the Tare, make sure that's not overheated. Shouldn't be, but I just wanna check. We're at 164, so we're almost there. Gonna keep an eye on it a bit closer. I need a measuring cup. Oh, and for today's hydration, let's go 38%. Somebody in chat wanna do 38 times four for me. Was it 152? 152. Are you getting a job at a local spice shop soon? All my interviews went very well. I'd started as a spice blender, super part-time. It's a really cool low-key play. Hell yeah. DM me where it's at if you get it. I want to stop in. I want some cedar spices. Yeah, that, doesn't that sound like the most cedarist job that I've ever heard of in my life? Right there with what? Tea blending, exactly. That's what I think of. That's hilarious. Well, I hope you get it. Fingers crossed for you, seriously. All right, 152 grams of water. I'm using cold water, by the way. That's important. Cold water behaves differently from warm water when it comes to rehydrating flour. Got it. Hang on, let me break 152. We're just adding water one drop at a time. There we go, 152. We did it. We need to do another thing? Absolutely. Want to give her the employee discount on something she was buying? It went that well. Wow. That's an endorsement. Super important in bread making too, yes. Hot water hydrates flour differently than cold water does. Now, unfortunately, cold water also makes it harder to dissolve things in it, which is exactly what we're about to try to do. So, we're gonna mix our salts together in a separate bowl. We need 3 grams of sodium carbonate, otherwise known as baking soda. I think I actually pan cooked mine though, dry. All right, 3 grams. That's too much. There we go. All right. Add that to our water. All right, we need 1 gram of potassium carbonate, which you can buy from any winemaking supply store. They use it to reduce acidity in wine. We just need 1 gram of that stuff. Dude, I nailed it. Hell yeah. Let's go. And then we need, I like to add 0.5% of salt, so we're gonna add 2 grams of salt. Why do you bake it? To increase the alkalinity. So baking soda, regular baking soda, let me check temp while I talk. Regular baking soda is sodium bicarbonate. Okay, we need 5 minutes on this stuff with no burner heat. And then when you bake baking soda, you raise the temperature. Those chemical bonds aren't very strong, so if you introduce a little heat, you can break them. And then you lose a little bit of CO2 and a little bit of hydrogen gas. And then you wind up with a lighter compound called sodium carbonate. It's a much higher pH. Since ramen noodles are alkaline in nature, you want to go ahead and try to emulate that as close as you can. It's easier to do with baked baking soda versus regular. Elsinger, oh snap, what are we making? Ramen. Making ramen noodles. Tare is just about done. Just need to give that about 5 minutes off of the heat. And then we'll strain that out. Set a timer. Good. All right, so we need 0.5 gram of sea salt. Oh, sorry, 2 grams of sea salt, 0.5%. Kid is watching with me now. She says hi. Hi, Molly's kid. Read the title of the stream. It's always there for you whenever you need it. But hey, that's what the host is for, too. All right, here we go. We're trying to get up to 2 grams of sea salt. You can use kosher salt or whatever. It doesn't matter. You're measuring it by weight, so it's fine. Two. Do I have two? There's two. Okay. Any MSG? Not in the noodles. Not in the noodles. If you want to, you can add it to the soup, or what I would prefer to do is add it to the bowl right before plating. But we are using so much kombu in this recipe, we will not need MSG. We will not need it. And for those who don't know, MSG, at least the Japanese brands of them, are all derived from kombu. So, sort of using the MSG precursor instead of MSG today. But if I'm making like a tonkotsu or a toripaitan, just a little sip of MSG in the bowl right when you're pouring the soup in, delicious. All right, so we've got our dissolved salts in here. You can see cold water with our pile of alkaline salts at the bottom. I'm gonna use a very specialized and technical tool to stir it and get it dissolved, called a chopstick. I'm gonna use the back half of it so I can tamp down the salts and get them to dissolve a bit faster. Dude, this apron is my favorite apron. My favorite apron. Been using it since I started the channel like 5 years ago. From kelp, yeah. So kombu, the same stuff that I was using earlier, this stuff. This is how Japanese companies manufacture MSG. Out of this, they refine it from kelp. Our recipe has so much kelp in it today, like we will not need MSG, I promise. Wait, is Joseph trolling? Please add the title of the stream to me. Read it to you. It is not visible from where I am. It's visible from where you are. Learn something today. I don't really think of my stream as very educational, so I'm gonna need you to knock that off. No, no. Whenever people do learn things here, it makes me happy. I'm not here to teach. I'm here to make better ramen myself. And seriously, if you guys learn anything by watching, that makes me very happy. Uncle Roger says, always use MSG. Well, Uncle Roger is not the single arbiter of all Asian food on the planet. So, you know, I would take his advice with a pinch of MSG. My mom and grandma use a lot of MSG. Yeah, there's nothing wrong with it. It's just, you know, it would be like kind of a waste of ingredients if I used it today because we're just using so much kelp, you know? Not to buy any more vanilla beans. But you can buy them from Cedar now. I made some banana bread off-stream skits using the extract that you made and the brandy. Whew, that was good. That was good. Do you like Maruchan or Top Instant Ramen? Neither of those I really go to. Of the two, I prefer Top Ramen. But if I buy Instant Ramen, it's normally Demae Icho, that brand I showed you earlier. Not arbiter of all Asian food. I mean, I'll fight the guy on it. I'll fight anyone. No. No, you know, I think my feelings on Uncle Roger are pretty complex. I like the idea of people being challenged to make better Asian food. But I don't know anyone else who claims to be an expert on Indian, Chinese, Japanese, Korean, Thai, Vietnamese food, Malaysian food. You know what I mean? I don't know anybody that claims to be an expert on all that, except for him. Something to think about. The bamba brab. Get a lot of umami from those fishies, though. Exactly. Do you save your spent kombu? Yogi, what's up? You definitely can. This was cooked in soy sauce, so it's a bit stronger. And you, what you can do is you can dry it and use it to make furikake, rice seasoning. But if you make it just in water to make dashi, you can just cut it up and eat it. It's delicious. Just a carrot? Yeah, exactly. That is wild that that keeps happening. It's the same fix, too. It happened a couple times yesterday. Every now and again, OBS will just stop accepting my microphone as default. Super weird. You also make pho. I have made pho. Definitely know less about it. And beef broth is, like, hard. Beef broth is hard to make. So unprofessional, I know. Is a healthy ladle of the soy sauce, mirin base I cook my pork in when I make my broth? Healthy ladle of the soy sauce, mirin base I cook my pork in. Oh, for tare. Use the tare from when you cook your chashu. Yeah, that is definitely valid. There's a huge ramen chain in Japan that does that called Jiro. Wait, no, that's incorrect, actually. They cook their chashu in the soup. There are lots of places that use the tare from the chashu. Somehow. All right, I might just strain this. Let's strain that into a different measuring cup here. And then I gotta strain the tare. It's about to be a big day for strainers in my kitchen. Can't leave any liquid behind because even 1 gram of difference could make or break these noodles. All right. Feel like that's good enough. That is our noodle water. I'm not going to take a sip of that no matter how bad I get thirsty. Chef in real life or just enjoy cooking. I like to call myself a very enthusiastic home cook. I have never worked in a restaurant beyond washing dishes. And that was when I was 19, and I am no longer 19, so. Three months and send help for real. Wait, what? I just have to make my own ramen now. It doesn't taste right. Only one local joint does it right, and they are always out of the door packed. I will say, things are getting better. Like, there's a lot of Japanese chains that are moving into the States now, which I sort of look at as a good thing. But, you know, ramen culture in America, I would kind of like to see become its own sort of category, you know? What is American ramen? What would it taste like? What ingredients would people use, you know? I like thinking about that stuff. Like, I did a Washington-style ramen that had some, you know, some apple shoyu and salmon dashi in it, and it was delicious. But, like, you would never find that on a menu in Japan. I just think it's really interesting that America has such a wealth of ingredients. Most people are just happy with tonkotsu. You know? Interesting. All right. Tare time. Let's make some tareable tare tate. Someone's aim is just walk a block or two for some ramen. I mean, Seattle is, like, luckier than most places. You know what I mean? Oh, I'm sorry you have a stomachache, Miss Kichi. Menu Musashi is legit. If you're ever in Seattle, I would highly recommend Menu Musashi. It is a chain, but it only has, like, a handful of locations around the world. I think they're rapidly expanding, though. But really well known for their tsukemen. It's like a dipping style of ramen. Delicious. All right, here's the transfer. Wish me luck. That looks like motor oil. That is dark. Gonna check it out, please do. Yeah, Menu Musashi, it's in Capitol Hill. What happens when you don't skip dessert? Yeah, exactly, Corporate. If I know anyone with a smoker, by the way, who's comfortable with me using it for a few hours, I would love to make some salmon katsu, some salmon bushi for Washington style ramen Mark II. I would really like to do that. All right. Man, that smells incredible. Okay. We've got our sake and mirin. I'm just going to pour those straight in through the strainer. And that's our tare. Done. Now, tare is so salty that it is painful to taste, so I'm not going to taste it. But a lot of people ask, when you're making tare, how do you know if it tastes right? And the answer is you really don't until you mix it with something. But I go by smell. That smells like it's going to taste really good. Inject it in my veins. Oh my gosh, you'd become a raisin. We have a ramen place, noodle shop downstairs, downtown. Not sure if it's 100% authentic. How can you tell? Authenticity's overrated. I actually try not to use the word authentic in my stream ever. Because, you know, white guy making ramen. I mean, you know, if you really wanted to split hairs. But, no, I think the main thing is just, do you enjoy it? And don't worry so much about authenticity. If you're looking for traditional, on the other hand, really depends on the type of ramen they're serving. Because, like, my advice for shoyu ramen would be totally different from miso. Miso ramen is super interesting, because, like, if you go into a place and they're making miso ramen, and they're cooking it in a wok right before it goes into the bowl, that's like Sapporo style. That's like Sapporo style miso. That's the thing. Doesn't mean that, like, a place that doesn't do that can't make good miso ramen, though. So. Heading up to Seattle in 1.5 weeks, so perfect. Yeah, yeah, Menu Musashi, check it out. Know someone with one, but I don't know if it's the right temperature for fish. Hot smoke. It's a hot smoke. You're basically, what you do is you boil or steam fish, transfer it once cooked into a smoker, and then you just smoke every last bit of moisture out of it. And then you can culture it if you want to, which is interesting. But most katsuobushi used for ramen is not cultured. They just use the regular hanakatsuo for it. So, yeah, yeah, hot smokes. Hot smokes, that's what you need. Tried to smoke some salmon in it and had a tough time. Oh, no. Food is also constantly evolving. Yeah, I mean, there's, you know, this style of ramen, as far as I know, is only been around since like the 80s or 90s, you know? And ramen itself has only been around since like the 50s. So, you know, there's Lanjo Lamyan, which is like the cousin dish, which has been around a lot longer. But, you know, Japanese ramen is relatively new. And in fact, a lot of Japanese people would straight up just call it Chinese food. So Just cook and save money, my mentality, and fun with it. I've been buying groceries and making challenges and what foods I can overlap in recipes, and it's been a fun couple of weeks. I need to try ramen now. If you ever have any questions, I mean, feel free. Like I said, I've been making ramen since like 2016 or something. And, you know, probably didn't make good ramen until about 2019. But I'll tell you what mistakes to avoid. All right, we need another chopstick. We got our alkaline water ready to go. Here's our noodle flour. Elsinger, thank you very much for that follow.
I'm gonna
get like just a plain chopstick. And give me. Wait, we got those plastic ones in Tapabashi. I'll use one of these. All right, so we got the egg white powder in there. You can sort of see the pale stuff. So I'm just gonna get that stirred in. Ibushi was cold smoked, huh? Yeah, no, it's hot smoked. Hot smoked. Buddy of mine, Ryan from Wave Ramen on YouTube, he made his own because they catch and eat that same fish in Hawaii. So he just uses dad's smoker and hot smoked the ass out of it. And it was all out of moisture. Worked. He has a video about it on his channel that's probably about 3 years old now. But yeah, definitely check that out. How long ago constitutes traditional, the staples of modern Japanese cuisine alone that have Western ingredients? Yeah, there's this whole branch of Japanese cooking called Yoshoku, which is Western food. And by definition, a lot of those haven't been around since, since after Matthew Perry's expedition. So it's like, you know, we have Japanese words for Western foods. What does traditional mean? Ramen goes back to northern China, right? It's all different folks putting new spins on existing techniques and making new interesting food. Yeah. Yeah, so ramyeon became ramen in Japanese, right? There's a few differences. The noodle is probably difference number one. And then flavoring is number two. Because Japanese ramen really sprung forth, fully evolved, when people started to use soy sauce as a flavoring suit the Japanese palate. But the noodles are also much lower hydration. Just getting a little flour on my hands because it helps. All right. Now the key here, because 38 grams of water for 100 grams of flour is a very low hydration ratio, the key here is to add it very slowly. I like to draw a little spiral in the top and then stir for about 30 seconds. Try to spill as much as you can on the counter. That's important. Pulled noodles. Yeah, pulled noodles are hot. Aren't you supposed to be working? She says, I'm multitasking. Yeah, pulled noodles are like much higher hydration. They have like dough relaxants in there sometimes. All different kinds of adjuncts. It's really a different animal altogether. They just share a name, you know? But you can tell I added a little bit of water and that made like no change in the dryness level of this dough. The audio is like super messed up for some reason. I got to go in and figure it out. Singer, I don't know if I want to say that out of context. So we're getting like these little lumps of dough in there. Slowly but surely. Even when we're done incorporating all this water, it's not going to look like a cohesive, clean dough. It's gonna look like a shaggy mess. There we go, we're just starting to come together there. We can go ahead and add the rest of the water, I think. That's it. That's all the water we're adding. I recommend adding just a little bit more water maybe doing like 40% hydration if you're using a pasta roller. But since I've got a Chinese noodle machine in my kitchen, I can go down to like 28, and it works. This is a 38% hydration, so it's dry enough to where we don't need to flour the noodles once they're pressed. But it does take a while for it to come together and hydrate properly, so this is normally where I swap up and use my hands. Low hydration, high hydration doughs always look like garbage in the beginning. They really do. I mean, look at this. That's not dough. But this is all the water it needs. I'm just getting all the moist parts off the side of the bowl because those make a huge difference in sort of pulling the whole thing together. And for soba, not for ramen, but for soba, they say that when it starts to look like rabbit poop, it's just about ready. I don't think we'll get there on this dough today. Just using my fingers to pull all of the sort of moist dough flecks off the side of the bowl. And there we go. There's our ramen dough. Doesn't it look so nice and easy to work with? Doesn't it look like you could just put a rolling pin to that and it would just immediately come together? Using your hands adds flavor. Well, it certainly adds love.